Hello, friends. This weekend marks a special milestone in the life of our congregation as we are celebrating the end of indebtedness. We've paid off a mortgage on our current buildings and properties, and I'm going to have a Cinco de Mayo themed taco bar lunch. And if you are watching this, that means, I guess, I assume that you are living too far away to be able to join us in person, and I'm missing you and wishing that you could be here with us. But I do hope that you will join us in prayer as we celebrate this accomplishment, and know that our hearts are with you.
We have two readings. The first reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We are God's co-workers, and you are God's field, God's building. I laid a foundation like a wise master builder, according to God's grace that was given to me. But someone else is building on top of it. Each person needs to pay attention to the way they build on it. No one can lay any other foundation besides the one that is already laid, which is Jesus Christ. So, whether someone builds on top of the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, grass, or hay, each one's work will be clearly shown. The day will make it clear, because it will be revealed with fire. The fire will test the quality of each one's work. Second reading is from John 15. As the Father loved me, I too have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have said these things to you, so that my joy will be in you, and your joy will be complete. This is my commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because servants do not know what their master is doing. Instead, I call you friends, because everything I heard from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and appointed you, so that you could go and produce fruit, and so that your fruit could last. As a result, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other.
Would you join me now in prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord, for you are our strength and our salvation. Amen. I was poking around the corners of the church over this past week and through some folders that Dick and Marilyn Bowman shared with me, and I found some old pictorial directories and photos and documents that sort of painted some glimpses of this congregation's history, which spans over 160 years. I don't believe that this is the first time that this church has celebrated the end of its indebtedness, because there have been several buildings and several locations over that long period of time. If you could get into a conversation with Alan Kuba or Dick Bowman, who is speaking in person this weekend, they could tell you probably more stories, and maybe more stories than you want to hear, not only about the current building and parsonage and granny unit and the education building that is currently rented by the La Petite Academy, which is all part of the mortgage that we have just recently paid off. But they could tell you stories about some of those other buildings, including the little yellow church where maybe some of you who are listening to this were baptized, or the pink cinder block that gets referred to as 195, as it was 195 Windsor River Road, currently occupied and worshipped in by the River Fellowship. There are folks among us who still remember, who may remember that move from the Yellow Church to the Cinder Block Church, and many more who remember, as Dick will be recalling for us, the move from downtown Windsor out to where we are on Brooks Road South. You may have ventured over to the historical wall that we have over in the sanctuary, which includes an old bit of stained glass and an old old cross and pictures of even older buildings and a plaque with a list of all of the names of the pastors, some of whom that are living sent us greetings since they could not join us for the celebration this weekend. I found a kind of mysterious photo in my wanderings around this past weekend. Don't know exactly where it came from, but it has a date on it, 1927. And it is a picture of young people, a large, considerable sized group of young people who are, as it's marked in the corner with the photographer's name and the date, was the occasion was the Epworth League Convention, which apparently had been hosted by Windsor in that year. I see pictures, see names on banners in that photo. Windsor is marked with a banner, and people are wearing crowns that have a W on them. There's also the name of one, on one banner, of a church, Mayfield, which no longer exists, but I remember the name of that church because it was a mission post in Palo Alto from the church that I served before I came, but it no longer exists. And it's a little bit bittersweet to look at that picture and think, probably none of us here knew those people that are pictured in there. Much love, blood, sweat, and tears went into all of the endeavors that are hinted at in all of those photos and documents, not to mention the investment of resources that was involved. Relationships were forged, no doubt, over the building of some of those buildings and church meetings and potluck suppers and Sunday school classes and mission projects and worship experiences. And I can only wonder at how many people came to know God more deeply through their connections with this faith community in this corner of Windsor, and how they came to live out grace to the end of their days. It boggles my mind enough to just think about all of the connections with people that I have had over the last 12 years that I've served this church, much less all of those others who have gone this way before. As the writer of the letter to the Hebrews said, we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. That reminder can bring great comfort in times of stress, if only we can stir up our creative imagination enough to listen for the sounds of those voices cheering us on. Today, I want to remind us what all of that history is ultimately about. It is not human glory that we are lifting up. Rather, it is love that calls us here. It is the love of God which empowers us to keep moving forward. It is our connection with God which empowers us to love. Not only loving those that are easy to love, but loving those who are not so easy to love. Not only loving those who attract our eye, but those whom social structures and constructs cause us not to see. The purpose of this foundation, which has been built for us to use and to which we have contributed, is not ultimately for us. It is for the healing of the world. And I'm not talking merely about beautiful and functional buildings when I talk about foundation, but about relationships. What is more important is the lives that have been touched by grace through teaching, through prayer, through expressions of care, through witness, through service, through acts of compassion. It's also through just growing and being vulnerable together. As Paul put it in his first letter to the church at Corinth, The people of faith are God's building. Or if you like the imagery better, the people are God's field. God's Spirit lives in the people just as surely as God's Spirit activates the life of the earth, its plants and trees and processes. We are one family, one household, with many housemates, and we share responsibility for one another's well-being. We will sing it at the close of worship in person. I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. The gospel reading from John is a good reminder that this business we're in is not about us, although we are blessed and privileged to be an important part of it. First of all, Jesus says, I love you. My joy is in you. You didn't choose me. In spite of what churches may emphasize about making a decision for Jesus or accepting Jesus as some kind of a merit badge or membership pass. No, Jesus says, I chose you. Furthermore, Jesus calls his followers friends, friends with intimate knowledge of God's business. And what are we to do as friends of Jesus? Be friends to one another. Love each other. Now, love may be easier said than done, since love is an action and love involves choices, and love is more than good feelings, and people are imperfect. But because Jesus chose us first, and God loved us first, our work gets to become joy, joy complete. May we celebrate in joy this day, and may we cherish one another, the memories that we make together, and the love and grace yet to be experienced. Amen.